Thank you so much, Aditya, for doing this for me.
Pretty excited to be part of another startup.
Yeah. I know. What is this? This whole country, there's a whole brouhaha happening as far as entrepreneurship is concerned.
To be frank and honest, the word scares me a bit. Because had it not been for spell check, I wouldn't have been able to write it down correctly. I always confuse myself in the E and the U and which one comes first. I think it is just the creation of value, right? By investing time. In my mind, that's the broadest definition of entrepreneurship that I can think of.
You know, there's a lot of excitement to invest monies as of now, as far as tech startups are concerned. And I think you yourself are looking to invest some amount of money as far as that space is concerned. And I have a pet peeve. I feel that there's the kind of evaluation of businesses that are being done are on projected businesses outputs that will happen some few years down the line, as opposed to what the business output is today. You know, there are so many companies that are really struggling to survive, so to speak, you know.
So I think always, I mean, this is not a new phenomenon. This has always been the case. People always bet on futures, right? And for some reason, most people believe that the future will always be better than what it is today.
Mm-hmm.
Right? That's one. The second thing is, I think a lot of people feel that they missed out on opportunities, and it's almost a catch-up that they're trying to do. It worries me because I think the principles are still the same. You're still supposed to invest your money to try and create something that is valuable to someone, and then sort of appropriate part of that value back to yourself. When you forget that there's this equation that works in business is when you start having some really horrible stories.
And what are those horrible stories? Like, nobody's talking about the horror stuff, huh? What the dark side of entrepreneurship? Behind every one successful entrepreneur, I guess there are a lot of other people who are struggling. So A, of course, we've got to keep them motivated. B, we've also got to show them the right picture, actually.
Sure.
What is the ground reality?
I don't think I know all the dark sides or all the bright sides for that matter. But I like to draw parallels when I don't have domain understanding somewhere, right? So look at the stock markets, right? Over the last 20 years, the Sensex has done, if I'm not mistaken, 16x, right? So it's the Sensex itself has gone up 16 times. And individual company stocks have done much, much better than that. There are people who have missed out this growth in the last two decades. You look at real estate, and a lot of people have missed out on growth that has happened in real estate in most of Indian metros. And in my mind, this missing out sort of creates a feeling that I want to be a part of that story as well. You know, everybody likes to tell stories of success.
Right.
And sometimes the dark side of entrepreneurship is feeding off this need to be a part of that success story.
What was it that kind of held you back for so many years turning into an entrepreneur? And what was it that made you overcome that fear factor for you to kind of get into this?
So let me separate investing and entrepreneurship.
Right.
So investing is largely driven by money, to some extent by time. So your input resources are money and time. Entrepreneurship is a completely different ballgame in my mind, because what you invest in entrepreneurship besides time and money is energy.
Right.
And I believe human beings are energy machines, right? And therefore, the biggest thing you generate is energy.
Mm-hmm.
The biggest thing you expend is energy. Mm-hmm. And entrepreneurship sort of sucks all that energy out of you and puts it into the business that you're trying to create. So what I'm looking for is people who actually have spent far more time, have far better understanding of that space than I do. You know, it's really interesting because I think I understand something well, you know, a particular category well. Maybe because I've spent 15 days reading about it and thinking about it, and I think that I know everything there is to know. And then I meet somebody who spent 16 months doing exactly the same thing and probably understands the past, present and future far better in that category than I ever will. Why would I not want to associate myself with that person? A lot of people approach me and a lot of my friends with ideas, but an idea is not fully formed till somebody is willing to pay for it.
Right.
And till then, it's not a business.
Right.
So what we're looking for is business ventures.
Mm-hmm.
Right. So that's the first thing you look at. Will somebody pay for this service or product or whatever? Right. The second thing is how deeply involved is this person or these group of people? How deeply are they involved with this venture?
Mm.
You know, does it consume their being for that period of time?
Mm.
Because I will never have either the expertise or the time to put into that venture, right? And they should. And if they see a better tomorrow than I do, then, you know, that's the reason why I'm backing them.
So have you invested in any up until now?
I have. So I started investing in public equities and startups sort of happened as I started getting interested in digital companies.
Right.
But the principle that I've always followed is that I don't talk about the specific company or the specific business idea because the more I talk about it, the more I convince myself that I'm right.
Mm.
Right? And that's such a big problem because then you don't allow yourself to be wrong. Right? And then even if the facts are, you know, stacked against it, the numbers are stacked against it, you're still telling yourself, no, I know this thing will work out because you've sort of publicly committed yourself to it.
Mm.
So I've kept away from talking about specific companies. The principles I think have largely been the same, which is try and understand the company, try and understand the business model of that company, look at the people who run it, look at why they are passionate, and most importantly, what problem are you solving to be able to create value. What are the first two or three things that I try to gauge from the interaction that I have? The first thing I try to look for is what is the real pain point that you're trying to solve? Right? So if you come up with an idea for transportation, right? So what's the actual pain point and how bad is that pain point really for people in general? Right? The second thing is there's this concept of TAM, total addressable market. Now what happens is when you think of when you're thinking of ideas, you're pretty enthusiastic about what you're doing, you're really looking forward to it. You see the world through that lens and you start thinking that everybody needs a service.
Right.
But the concept of total addressable market actually helps you temper your enthusiasm and try and identify what is the business end of this idea. Right. So let's take an example of, somebody comes up with some sort of a solution for headaches. Right. Who is it applicable to? Most people will say, everybody has a head, men, women, kids, grown-ups, adults, elders, senior citizens, everybody. And therefore, a solution for headache is actually applicable to everybody, right? But then you think a little bit more about it and say, so who will pay for this? So for someone to pay for this solution, they should have the problem far severe as compared to everybody else.
Mm.
Right? There are far simpler solutions. You take a nap sometimes and your headache goes away. You apply some balm and it goes away.
You have a girlfriend massage your head, that's the best, I guess.
Your experience, not mine. But, so there are so many other solutions that are applicable. So you have to look at the subset of people who have such bad headaches that they are willing to pay for the solution that you're trying to put out in the market, right? And if that is 1% of the population, then you no longer have 1.2 billion people to cater to.
Correct.
You have only 1% of those, right? That's the second thing. The third thing is how long are you willing to stay this role? Right? What brings you to this? Why are you interested in solving this problem? Often defines how long you're willing to solve it, right? So most good entrepreneurs that I know are not actually interested in the business. They are interested in some pet peeve that has probably interested them or troubled them for far longer and will perhaps continue to trouble them for far longer after this business lives, survives and thrives.
Okay.
Right. So I have a lot of friends who have sports startups, right? Sports oriented startups, and some people do sports equipment, some people do sports training, but what they're really trying to do is when they were kids, they didn't have facilities which they want to provide.
Right.
And then they see the world through that lens and they say, these days kids don't have playgrounds, they don't have great services, etc., etc. And they sort of construct a business. I've always been a movie buff. I lose myself in stories. Most friends, my family, they hate going for movies with me because I don't respond to anybody around me. I'm completely lost in the narrative. And whether I find a business model or not, I will continue to be like this, you know, for the next 30, 40, 50 years.
Right.
I mean, you know, while I was traveling here, I was watching a movie on my phone. And for that time, I'm completely lost in it. So if you can identify why you're interested in that problem that you're proposing a business idea for,
right,
it works for you, it works for your investors, it works for your customers, and your customers almost sense it. So I think it's somewhere there.
This is almost like a spiritual nirvana kind of a thing, that what is your sore point? What is it that is your pet peeve? And accordingly, you will focus your life's energies towards
True.
That and be more passionate towards it and, you know, get that out
the door. So my... And a lot of my friends laugh at this, but my belief is that if you can bring all of your life's activities, interests down to some few motivations, life becomes easier, you enjoy yourself a lot more, and the work that you do pays back emotionally before it pays back financially. Unless you fail, you don't know what not to do, right?
Okay.
And that's very, very important, because experience counts for a lot, right? So I'll talk about some specific things that that I almost taken on as lessons. So in the tech space, most people talk about an MVP, right? Minimum viable product. And my first rule is that if your MVP is going to take you a year to build, it's not an MVP anymore,
mm-hmm.
right? So you got to be able to quickly identify what is the core problem you're trying to solve, build a product around it, expose it to people, and learn from that. Rather than saying, you know, I'm going to build this whole big Taj Mahal and it's the final service that's actually going to, you know, deliver value.
Right.
I don't think that's really possible in today's ecosystem. You got to be able to attract people with diverse skill sets. Right? So most people have one primary skill, you know, either you're a marketeer or you're a business person, a salesperson, or you're a tech guy, and you need the other skill sets to come and work with you
right.
to be able to make a successful business.
Right.
I've seen a lot of people, you know, stutter with how do I get somebody else on board as a co-founder or the same level. If you can't get a CTO interested in your tech idea,
right.
fat chance you're going to get consumers interested in it,
mm-hmm.
right? So I think it's almost a test of how good your idea is. If you can get other people to get interested in it, buy into it, build your team well, then it just shows that, you know, you'll find more success in the future. The third thing is, do your paperwork well. It's a, you know, India is a very difficult country to do business in. And a lot of people tend to say, okay, we'll see how it goes and then we'll do the paperwork.
No, on the contrary, but it's been pegged as the number third only after UK and US in terms of the startup ecosystem, you know, supporting this whole...
So wherever you have regulatory delays, wherever you have stumbling blocks in terms of official ways of getting things done and done quickly,
right.
you have parallel ecosystems that develop.
Right.
Right. So you have a lot of angels who are willing to give their time
Correct.
To tell you how to do something.
Right.
But the fact that there are so many angels telling you means that there is no official channel, you know, existing. And that's what they're trying to replace. That's the need that they're trying to fill. So the presence of that ecosystem almost tells you that, you know, the official channels don't work as well, right? So I think it's very necessary, very important for a team, a young team, to be as clear on their paperwork as early and hold that discipline as they grow. Because the whole idea of a startup is that you are scalable to maybe 100x
Correct.
In the first 24 months, right? Maybe in terms of just consumers, if not in terms of value.
So there's a lot of jargon floating around as far as startups and entrepreneurs are concerned, and we're going to ask you, test your knowledge on that. Bootstrapping.
Paying for your own ideas.
Paying for your own ideas.
Yeah.
All right, we'll give it to you. Churn rate.
Oh, the number of people who came onto your service and then figured out this is not as good as they thought it would be.
Damn. All right. Accelerator.
A sort of school or a classroom that helps you or forces you to think through your ideas and get them out of the door fast.
All right. I think you're pretty well versed with all of this. Freemium.
A lack of a good promise, I would say. you tell somebody that it's free, and then once they're in the door, you sort of charge them. So.
And you've heard that a lot, right?
Yeah. If there's one thing that you can do in the hope of an entrepreneurial journey, I would say make decisions. Make as many decisions as you can. Take calls on as much, you know, literally count the number of decisions you take in a day, because that's the one big difference between people who succeed and people who don't.
Excellent.
People who succeed take more calls all the time, and some of those calls work out, right? Because everybody's got a failure rate. Most people who don't succeed are the ones who say, oh, I'll do it if this happens, when this happens. So I would say just take as many calls as you can.
All right. Thank you so much, Aditya.
Thank you.